to throw, I'm going to put up my share screen here for you while I am getting ready. So let me start off by stating the obvious. We're not in person, so we don't get to share this time and space together, but I'm really happy that we're able to come to the Zoom space and talk a little bit about Midwestern Latino communities. I also want to say this is probably one of my first talks with an audience in Illinois, and today is really important for me to say that because I'm a big Brewers fan and my Brewers are facing elimination tonight against the Atlanta Braves. And if I had known it was going to be tonight, I promise I would not have scheduled this talk for today. I know this matters to none of you who are probably mostly Cubs fans, but I just needed to say it from the beginning. I'm an assistant professor of Latinx studies, not of sports, but of Latinx studies here at Marquette University. And my focus as a scholar of U.S. labor and immigration and working class history is specifically on Latino communities here in the Midwest. And what I want to do today with you is to tell a little bit about the history of Latinos in this region that we call home. My emphasis specifically is on Wisconsin history, and so that's going to be a large part of the conversation tonight. But I'm going to pepper in some other stories for us to think about, and then hopefully leave some time at the end for us to have a conversation. So we are obviously here in Hispanic Heritage Month. If you didn't know it, now you do. September 15th to October 15th, a month that is supposedly meant to recognize the accomplishments and the contributions of Latino and Hispanic communities to the United States. It's a fraught time for professors of Latino communities in the United States because it's a time when we get a lot of requests to do talks. And then after October 15th, everyone disappears. No one seems to be interested anymore in Latino communities. And so I'm hoping our conversation today serves as just kind of a seed, a start for your interest in this topic, and that even after Hispanic and Latino Heritage Month finishes October 15th, you continue to do a little bit of research and learn more about these communities. So why are we talking about Midwestern communities, Latino communities specifically? Why are we here for this conversation? Well, I want to start off by talking a little bit about my own journey to becoming a professor and to understanding these communities, and to get kind of to Valerie's point here, to give a little bit of a bio background on what I do. When I went to graduate school, beginning in 2012, I was leaving a career as a middle school teacher, and I was going into this really long process of getting my master's degree and then my PhD at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And I knew I wanted to study history, and I knew I wanted to study Latino communities. Both of my parents are originally from Jalisco, Mexico. They came to the United States at different times in the second half of the 20th century. And, you know, I really wanted to understand more about Latinos in the place that I call home. I also was really interested in decentering the conversation in the place where we often think about Latino communities. And, you know, this probably will not be a surprise for many of us. Over the last 4 years, really specifically, but really throughout most of my lifetime, when national media outlets and pundits and journalists talked about Latino communities, they often began their conversation with this image and this location, and too often the conversation kind of finished here as well. This is, of course, the border wall that separates the United States and Mexico. And in the last presidency, this image was kind of emblazoned across television screens quite often, and kind of the theatrics that go along with it. And really, since that previous administration, oftentimes our conversations about immigration and migration and Latino settlements in the United States focus really heavily on this image and this space. But the reality is that when I was growing up, this location didn't really mean much to me personally. As I mentioned, my parents are both from Jalisco, Mexico, which is in the central part of Mexico. And they came to the United States and they settled here in Wisconsin. So when I thought about Latino communities, I didn't think about the border wall and the U.S.-Mexico borderlands. I thought about this. I thought about the city of Milwaukee, the place that I grew up, the place that I called home. Even when I went to college, I still considered it home. And now that I'm a professor at Marquette University in Milwaukee, it's the place that I call home again with my family. And so when I thought about Latino communities, I thought about this space. And as a graduate student, I was really interested in understanding why Latino communities had come to the Midwest, specifically to Wisconsin, of all the places, mostly because I wanted to understand why my parents had come to this region. Why had they settled here instead of, you know, a warmer climate like Texas or California, Arizona, or even Miami, right? Why here? And so that was kind of the big picture question that guided my first kind of dipping of toes into graduate research in 2012. In 2013, I had the opportunity to do my first visit to the archives, right? So kind of my first time to actually put on my big historian pants and start doing the archival research that is central to our work in recovering the stories of the communities that we want to get to know. My first trip to the archives was to the Milwaukee County Historical Society, which is in downtown Milwaukee. It's this beautiful old refurbished bank. And I went into this location and I said to the archivist, I'm so-and-so, I'm a new graduate student. I want to see everything that your archival society has preserved for Latino communities. I want to see everything that you have. And, you know, this type of request, you would imagine might have brought out a lot of materials for me to dig into, maybe institutional records and personal memoirs and oral histories and paraphernalia, all of the things that may have documented the history of this community, of this Latino community. The archivist looked at me and nodded and went back into the room and came back a few minutes later with two boxes. And he put them down in front of me and he said, here you go. This is what we have. And so I thought to myself, oh my good, this is gonna be the shortest dissertation that's ever been written. Two boxes, what am I supposed to do with such little material? After I got over my initial shock of this is all that we have, I opened the first box and I pulled out a document. I want to share that document with you. So I want you to take a look at this document here. And I don't know if I can see the chat, but we're going to try something here. Yes, I can see the chat. If you could do me a favor in the chat, if you're feeling so bold and brave, if you can just type down, what are the things that you see in this image? What are your observations in this image? What do you see here? Babies and churches from Mary. Thank you, Mary. Baptism from RJ. That's a good guess. Family, happy family, and newborn baby. Mm-hmm. That's pretty good. You guys hit most of the key points here in this image here. So that's exactly right. You're seeing exactly what I'm seeing. But maybe what you don't see, and how would you know? 80s hair. Thank you, Mara. Yeah, that's very true, 80s hair. Maybe what you're not seeing, but I can definitely see, is that when I opened this box and I pulled out this newspaper from the Milwaukee Journal Magazine, I saw an image of myself. This actually me. That baby is me. I'm just a few months old. I was born April 30th, so I'm just a few months old here. And those families are my families. That's my mom, that's my dad, my aunts here in the background. And it's not my baptism, it's just any other Sunday morning, but we are indeed leaving a church and we're all very happy, right? So, I mean, I had this existential moment where I literally found myself in the archives. I found myself and I found my family in the research that I wanted to do on the first day that I was actually doing research. It was a very surreal moment. And after I kind of got over this very personal experience, I, you know, put my historian's hat back on and I started to think about, what is this image? What is this archival find telling me? What is the story here? And I looked at the chyron, the wording at the bottom of the image here. And I thought to myself, what does it mean that the Milwaukee Journal, which is the newspaper of record in Milwaukee, is saying that the pulse of Hispanic Milwaukee, all of these families leaving a church on a bright Sunday morning, happy, joyful, building a sense of community. What does it mean that this is the pulse of Hispanic Milwaukee? And this find is the thing that got me thinking, what if I thought about religious places as locations where Latinos have turned to as places of community formation, as places of solace, as places of sanctuary, but also as places to build solidarity and to perhaps strategize for how to push back in locations that have not always been hospitable to them. And so this kind of first initial find in the archives really set forward the main questions that I ask as a historian of the Midwest, which is, how do communities of Latino descent of so many different backgrounds, whether they're Mexican, Puerto Rican, Cuban, Salvadoran, Guatemalan, how do they, when they arrive in this region, first of all, why do they come here? Second, how do they make a sense of community for themselves? Where do they find that community? And then perhaps most importantly, when they sometimes feel like they're not at home in their new homes in the Midwest, how do they develop a sense of home? How do they create a sense of belonging in these places? So this is kind of the thing that really got me thinking about my project and really got me kind of brewing as I became a kind of a budding historian of the Midwest. So I want to do a little bit of a thought experiment with you all here tonight. So a little another opportunity for you to drop some observations or some ideas in the chat, if you would, all right? So let's take a look at this image here. Now, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to close your eyes and imagine a Midwesterner. All right, so close your eyes. Just humor me. I can't see you. If we were in a room together, I'd be making sure that you were actually closing your eyes. So close your eyes and imagine a Midwesterner. Who do you see? Do me a favor, in the chat, drop in who you see when you imagine a Midwesterner. Jameson says, my son's girlfriend's grandparents. All right, I'm trying to do the family, but my son's girlfriend's grandparents. Okay, all right. Farmers and families. Thank you, RJ. My college roommate. Okay. Any other ideas? Who else do you see when you close your eyes and imagine a Midwesterner? Dairy farmer. All right. Dairy farmer. I appreciate that. That's often who I think of as well, Mary. I often think of the bigger dairy farmer. And in some ways, I know I've kind of clouded the field here by showing you this image of a farm, right? So it kind of automatically sets this image. It's an image of farms in Iowa. And when I close my eyes and think of a Midwesterner, I sometimes also think of a dairy farmer. But just as I think of a dairy farmer, I also think about that image I just showed you. I think about my family. I think about the fact that places like Milwaukee, where I grew up, are a lot more diverse than oftentimes people outside of the Midwest often think of this region, right? When they think of the Midwest, they either have these ideas of it being a flyover region, of it being America's heartland, but oftentimes it is a place where it's a location of farmers and specifically of white farmers. But the reality is that the history of the Midwest has always been much more diverse and much more complicated than that kind of simple understanding. I want to, for us to think about today, and part of our time together here today, I want us to walk away with this idea that this idea of the imagined Midwest is far from reality, right? So the idea of the Midwest that many people have when they think about this region, as Sue Hebega, one of the great scholars of Latino communities in the Midwest, the reality is that the Midwest is a lot more complicated than that. I want to show you some maps to kind of put this into perspective for us, right? So we just had the 2020 census numbers come out, which give us really great information about the changing demographics of our region. And I want to show us the state maps of some of the states that are part of the Midwest. And we're going to start with Illinois, your home state. Illinois from 2010 to 2020 saw a 15% increase in its Latino population. And it's fascinating to look at this map because you see kind of different areas of change across different counties in the state. Chicago, of course, and kind of the northeast part of the state where a large Latino population has historically lived, actually had a pretty small percent change in comparison to other parts of the state, specifically in both the central and the southern parts of the state. So 15.3%, that's a really big number, right? That's a pretty big jump. Of course, Chicago and Illinois are home to the largest Latino communities in the Midwest and one of the largest Latino communities in the United States. But the largest changes, the percentage changes in the Midwest did not happen in Illinois. They didn't happen in Chicago. They've happened in other places, places like Michigan, which saw a 29% jump in its Latino population. And you can see how there were jumps in almost every single county in the state except for two. In Minnesota, Minnesota witnessed a 38% jump in its Latino population, right? So we're getting bigger here, even bigger. And again, almost every single county witnessed a rise in its population. In Indiana, Indiana's Latino population is booming, almost 50% jump, right, in Indiana. And you see kind of these huge jumps happening in multiple counties, 100% or more change happening in multiple counties. And then Iowa, which saw a 42% jump. right? And Iowa happening in almost every one of its counties as well. Iowa now very much dependent on Latino laborers for their agricultural industry. So these are kind of graphic examples to tell us that the imagined Midwest today is far from reality. But my job as a historian is for us to think about this not just in the current context and not just looking at these maps that are charting demographic shifts in 2020, but I want us to think about this a little bit bigger. I want us to think of this within a wider frame. So I want us to think about this question here. And if once again, if you could use the chat function to drop your answers. When do you think the first Latinos began arriving in the Midwest? A, the 1840s, B, the 1880s, C, the 1920s, or D, the 1940s? All right, everyone wants to go far back, all right? Kat's taking a 1920s here, all right? John's going with B, wanna go with the first answer as B. Anybody else? All right, well, John, I appreciate it. You are correct. I appreciate everyone's response, but John is correct. 1880s is actually the time when historians have documented the arrival of the first Latinos in the Midwest in this very region. And you might already kind of know the answer here. What was the thing that drew Latinos to the Midwest and specifically Mexican descent people to this region? It was work. The first Latino descent people to come to this region were people of Mexican descent, both mostly Mexican migrant workers coming from the borderlands region. And they were drawn here very specifically for agricultural labor. They arrived in the 1880s in states all across the region. They arrived in Minnesota, in Michigan, in Iowa, and in Wisconsin. And they arrived at first to do a very specific type of agricultural work. And that was to do sugar beet work in places like Michigan, like you see here in Saginaw again in the 1950s as well. And so the thing that drew Latinos to this region over 100 years ago was that very question of labor, right? They were needed to do this very specific migrant agricultural work. And so they would come to the region, they would live here often from the planting through the harvest season from the spring until the fall. And then when that region, season ended after the crop was harvested, they would head back down south either to Mexico or to the US-Mexico borderlands region. And so that means that they were constantly interacting with the Midwest. They were constantly interacting with communities in East Grand Forks, Michigan, and constantly interacting with communities in Saginaw, Michigan, and constantly interacting with rural communities all across Illinois, Minnesota, and Wisconsin. Which means that I want us to think about this region not just as the heartland, but to think of it within the context of how Indiana defines itself, right? The state of Indiana calls itself the crossroads of America. And so I think it's important for us to think about the Midwest as the crossroads for Latino Midwest as well. And that the Midwest has been a crossroads and a borderland for Latino America as an entire nation. That Latinos have been coming here and crossing across this region back and forth, sometimes settling, but often migrating back and forth across different regions for over 100 years, that they have called themselves members of the Midwest for quite some time. And so if we walk away from nothing else tonight, if we remember one thing about this presentation, I want us to wipe away this idea that Latinos are newcomers to the Midwest. If we were to only to focus on those maps that I just showed you, this percentage change, right? To think that there has been 40% and 50% change in some of these states, we might say that Latinos are newcomers to the Midwest, that their demographic change is something that is unheralded, unprecedented. But the reality is that Latinos have been coming here for so long that it's impossible for us to say that. A fantastic book called Latino Midwest Reader. It's a volume from the University of Illinois Press, which collects a number of articles documenting the history and the cultural contributions of Latinos to this region. Notes that the Latino Midwest is a region of distinct but overlapping Latinidades, right? Latino identities, rural and urban, established and emergent, which have been forged over the past 1.5 centuries through labor migration, through urbanization, through placemaking, and through cultural production. And so that's what I want us to think about today. I want us to think about all these different components, the ways in which Latinos have come to this region because of labor, have engaged in processes of urbanization, have made places for themselves, and have produced culture throughout all of that time. And I think the Midwest is a really fascinating place to have this conversation because Latinos have been coming here since the 1880s, but of course, the Midwest was settled by immigrants all across the 19th century as they displaced indigenous communities that originally called this this region home, immigrants are the ones that really made the Midwest what it became in the 19th century. This is a map showing populations in the 1910s across the United States. And I want us to focus on, of course, the Midwestern region here at the top. And just to look at the density of both immigrant foreign-born and children of foreign and mixed parentage populations across the Great Lakes region and across the Midwest. So if you look at Minnesota, Wisconsin, Iowa, the upper half of Illinois, Michigan, and the upper halves of Indiana and even Ohio, immigrants really populated at the turn of the century a large part of these states. They really made these states what they became and what we know them as today. Some of you may know, of course, that as immigrant populations arrived in the United States and began to populate all across the United States in the early 20th century, some Americans, native-born Americans, saw these growing populations of immigrants with a bit of unease, right? They saw the arrival of people coming from places like Southern and Eastern Europe, like Poland, like Greece, like Italy, and like Russia, with a certain sense of trepidation. Some Midwesterners came to see these newly arriving populations, not just as a curiosity, but as potentially as a threat as well to the way in which they understood life in the Midwest. These were conversations that were happening all across the country. I appreciate your comment, Jameson, about your grandparents coming around this time, right? So they're a part of this history. Immigrants arrived in the early 20th century and were often perceived by native-born Americans as being both an anomaly, but also as a potential threat. And so to kind of stem the arrival of all of these populations and potentially to kind of put a stop on immigration to the United States, the U.S. Congress passed a series of immigration laws in the early 20th century, in the 1920s. The most important one, the Immigration Act of 1924, also known as the Johnson-Reed Act, which for all intents and purposes cut off immigration, at least at the high volumes at which it had been occurring from Europe. And so the United States put up a stop sign at Ellis Island, and they basically shut off most of the immigration that had been arriving from Southern and Eastern Europe in an effort to kind of stop the changing face of the nation. There was one big problem with that, of course. If the US Congress was gonna cut off immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe, they were also going to be cutting off the large labor pool that many industrialists and agriculturalists depended on across the United States, right? That cheap and controllable labor force that many of those companies depended on. So when Congress passed this law in the 1920s, they actually left a little loophole in those immigration laws, also known as the quota laws of the 1920s. While they cut off immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe, they actually left the door open to Mexico. And a very explicit conversation was had in Congress to leave a labor pool available for employers. And the reason they chose the Western Hemisphere and specifically Mexico to kind of be exempted from these quotas was that congressmen said that this Mexican immigration would not be the same type of immigration that was happening from Europe. Most importantly, that Mexican immigrants would not be coming to the United States to settle, right? Obviously, if you're coming from Europe, you're making a big investment to get on a ship, both a financial investment and kind of a social investment to get on a ship and travel months to come across the Atlantic Ocean and eventually arrive in the United States. Congressmen noted that Mexicans would be like birds of passage. You know, they would come here in the harvest season, they would do their jobs, and then they would take a train and head back to Mexico when their employment was over. And they called them birds of passage, kind of alluding to the idea of a goose or a duck following the seasons going north and south according to the weather. And so that was the promise that was made in leaving the door open to Mexico. These immigrants are not going to be the same issue. They're not going to present the same problems as their predecessors. And so companies all across the United States, including in the Midwest, began to look to Mexico to recruit laborers, right? They needed to continue to fill their workforce. One of those companies that did that was the Pfister and Vogel Tannery in Milwaukee. The Pfister and Vogel Tannery sent labor recruiters into the central states of Mexico and to places like Jalisco and Michoacán and Aguascalientes. These labor recruiters were called enganchistas. In Spanish, enganchar means to hook. And so these labor recruiters went down to the central states of Mexico to hook workers and bring them back northward. in the 1920s, Mexico had just finished up a really traumatic and violent revolutionary war. The country was devastated economically, and many of the young men in the country were looking for economic opportunities to support themselves and their families. And so they signed limited term contracts with companies like the Pfister and Vogel tannery. They would sign these contracts for maybe 6 months of employment. They would get on their trains and they would head up northward through the Midwest. And maybe they would jump off in Iowa or Indiana or Illinois on the way up to Wisconsin. But many of them eventually made it up to the tannery here in the city. Now, the thing that the Pfister and Vogel tannery labor recruiters had not told these young Mexican workers is that they were being brought up to the United States to function as strike breakers. Companies like the Pfister and Vogel tannery were often engaged in the 1920s in labor disputes with their unionized workforces, many of them German and Polish American workers. And instead of bargaining in good faith with their unionized workforce, they just went to go and look for scabs somewhere else. And of course, never telling those workers that they were coming up as strike breakers. So the first instance that Milwaukeeans, the first interactions that Milwaukeeans had with these new arriving Mexican workers was that these people were coming to the United States to steal Americans' jobs. And that's probably a well-worn canard that some of you on this conversation have heard in the past, that immigrants are only coming here to take the jobs of citizen Americans. It's kind of an old and tired phrase that goes back over 100 years and is one that is often created by employers who are looking to maintain a very cheap and pliable workforce under their control. Now, you might think to yourself, well, after those kind of false pretenses, why would workers continue to come to Milwaukee? Well, or to the Midwest in general? Well, the reality was that the work was really good. And as I mentioned, the economic situation in Mexico was really rough. And so these workers continued to come northward. These are some of the men that came to Milwaukee. And at first, throughout much of the Midwest, when these individuals were recruited to work in the Midwest, they were young men because they were only needed and only wanted for one very specific reason, that was to be workers. Now, remember, they had been brought up here for 6 month contracts or 1 year contracts, very limited term contracts. But the work was good, the pay was good, the living conditions were, well, we'll talk about those in a little bit, but at a minimum, these men could provide for themselves and for their families. And so they kept signing the contracts and they kept staying in places like Milwaukee and places like Chicago. And pretty soon, across place, urban places like Milwaukee and Chicago and Detroit and St. Paul, what had initially been small groups of men working in tanneries, often sleeping in cots inside the tanneries, began to form into families. These young men would start to bring their families northward. They would have children, usually in the United States as well. So these would be American-born children. And they started to form loosely knit communities around the places in which they work. And so this became the case in urban centers all across the Midwest. There were small colonias or colonies that developed around the factories and foundries and tanneries where Mexican men had been recruited and where they had brought their families. And the reason that they settled around the factories and foundries is not because it was convenient to get to work every morning, but mostly because those were the cheapest places to live. They were the dirtiest places to live, which meant that they were the only places available for these Mexican families to actually find apartments. No housing, obviously, because they couldn't afford houses, and most Midwesterners were not going to sell them an actual house, especially in places like Chicago or Milwaukee or Detroit. And so many of them rented or roomed in rooming houses. In Milwaukee, Milwaukee's Latino community in 1910 numbered at about 50 Mexican descent people. By the end of the 1920s, that number had grown anywhere to 5,000 to 7,000 people. So this community really jumped up within just a decade, really grew really quickly. Midwesterners were a bit confused. They had been told that Mexicans were going to be birds of passage, that they weren't going to settle in their Midwestern temporary homes, that they weren't going to try to become Midwesterners. But pretty quickly, all across the Midwest, we had these developing neighborhoods or barrios, colonias that were developing in urban spaces. And so Midwesterners were confused not only with the fact that they were staying, but they also were interested in who these people were. And so throughout the late 1920s and early 1930s, settlement agencies, immigrant settlement organizations, sociologists, different academics tried to get to understand who these people were, right? who are these Mexicans? Why are they linguistically different? They practice their faith differently. Their cultural celebrations are different. Some of them seem to be racially different, right? Perceived to be racially distinct by white Midwesterners. And so in the 1920s and 1930s, a lot of these settlement organizations would send out social workers into the communities, and they would try to get to understand who these people were. And I want to share one of the reports that was conducted in Milwaukee in the 1920s and 1930s. In 1930, the International Institute, which was kind of Milwaukee's Hull House in the 1920s and 1930s, sent out a social worker into the Mexican colonia to try to understand who these people were. And she prepared a report. It was called The Mexicans of the City of Milwaukee. And her report in part said this: "Do you know how intimate an American problem the Mexican has become?" So within the span of just 10 years, this newly arriving population, this growing population in urban spaces in the Midwest, has transformed from a potential labor source, one that labor recruiters are bringing intentionally into the Midwest. They've now become an intimate American problem that needs to be solved. So you might be asking yourself, well, what's the problem here? What's the problem this social worker, Agnes Fenton, is identifying? Well, she goes on to say in the report, "While the social workers are afraid that the peons will not mix with our native population, the eugenicists are afraid that they will. It is certain that interbreeding cannot be prevented. Now, it'd be considered a happy ending if the quality of our racial stock were not lowered in the process. If the stock of the Mexican is as good as ours, there can be no scientific objection. But there are, however, competent and impartial observers who consider the peon inferior to the whites, both physically and mentally." The problem here, according to the social worker, according to the settlement agency, is that the Mexican population is not only staying in Milwaukee, but they may try to, using her language, interbreed with the native white population. They might try to engage in social mixing and potentially in marrying and then having children. And the fear here, according to Milwaukeeans, is that this will lower the quote-unquote racial stock of the United States, that this will have really deleterious effects. In fact, it's going to do the very thing that Americans were hoping to prevent when they passed the Immigration Acts of the 1920s. So you can kind of imagine the social atmosphere that Mexicans might have found in urban spaces all across the Midwest. They were not welcoming spaces. And so when they couldn't find a sense of social comfort and social belonging in places like Chicago, in Milwaukee, and in Detroit and St. Paul, people of Mexican descent started to turn inward, and they created their own community institutions amongst themselves. They did things like create mutual aid societies. This is Milwaukee's first mutual aid society, La Sociedad Mutualista Hispano Azteca. And there were mutual aid societies, Mexican mutual aid societies, all across the Midwest. And every single Midwestern state had at least one, if not multiple, mutual aid societies. They turned to sports. They turned to a sense of recreation, creating all Mexican baseball teams like Los Amigos Baseball Club. And in Milwaukee, this baseball club often played against other ethnically defined baseball teams. There were Polish teams and German teams and Slovenian teams. And so they would play against each other. And then they would create their own religious spaces as well. So here is Our Lady of Guadalupe Catholic Mission Chapel, with which Mexican Catholics created in 1926 in Milwaukee with the help of the Catholic Archdiocese. They took an old beat up storefront and they turned it into this. It had been kind of a rundown storefront. They were able to garner a bunch of donations from local churches and transform it into this space that they felt could really honor their sense of Catholicism and their sense of faith, where they can join together and really feel a sense of community. And they also found ways to celebrate who they were through the city streets. And so this is Milwaukee and Wisconsin's first Mexican Independence Day parade in 1930. And I want to point out a few things here. So obviously you see the long parade of cars. This is a way in which Mexican descent people were claiming space in the city that often saw them as distinct, right? And when they couldn't feel like they belonged, they kind of reclaimed that space on their own by driving their cars in a long procession in their neighborhood. The other thing that you see here is the flags. I want you to look at these flags. The lead car here, the lead truck, is carrying two different flags. The Mexican flag, obviously, to honor Mexican Independence Day, but also the American flag, as these Mexican migrants are trying to find their place in their new homes in the Midwest, right? They're trying to navigate what it means to belong, not just as a Mexican immigrants and Mexican migrants in this region, but also as potential Americans. And especially for their children who are born in the United States and carry American citizenship with them, what does it mean to be a person of Mexican descent in this region? People of Latino descent continued to come to the Midwest throughout the 20th century. And by the mid-20th century, specifically the 1940s and 1950s, the people arriving in the Midwest were often not just people directly coming from Mexico, so Mexican immigrants. They were people of Mexican descent, but they were coming from the U.S.-Mexico borderlands. They were people coming from Texas, places like Crystal City. And these were migrant agricultural workers. They would come to the Midwest every single season to pick anything and everything that you can imagine. So if you can imagine any sort of crop that was being grown in the Midwest, Mexican descent hands were often doing it. These people were called Tejanos or Texas Mexicans. And they would follow the crops all across the United States, but they would come in the number in tens of thousands of numbers here to the Midwest, to Minnesota, Iowa, Indiana, Illinois, Michigan, and Wisconsin and Ohio. And I want to tell a little bit about the people who came to Wisconsin, people like Filberto and his family who came to Door County, which is in Northeast Wisconsin. Some of you may have traveled to Door County, which is a beautiful vacation spot right off of Lake Michigan. Filberto and his family would come every single year in the 1940s and 1950s to pick cherries. In reality, the Midwest's agricultural industry became dependent on Tejano migrant farm workers who came every single harvest season to both plant and to harvest these crops. So I want us to think a little bit about Filberto and his family who worked long day in the fields. They either engaged in what's called reach labor, so that's where they're reaching up in the trees to do this work, or they engaged in stoop labor where they're bending over every single day to harvest plants off of the ground. And you might imagine, I don't know if any of you have ever done this type of work, it's very difficult work. It's literally backbreaking work. You're working out in the sun every single day. You get paid for what you pick. And so there's obviously an expediency to get as much as you can and turn it in to the farmer to get paid. After a long day of doing this work, a migrant family might have decided to find a sense of relief, a sense of recreation. The thing to know about migrant farm worker labor is that it was often in the middle of the 20th century family work. If you could stand, you were often out in the fields picking. And so if you were a young person, a little kid, you might be out there helping your parents. And if you were an elderly member of the family and you could stand the work, you might be out there as well, right? As a way to contribute to the family. So after a long day of working in the fields, families like Filberto's may have been looking for a sense of recreation. And specifically in the 1940s and 1950s, Filberto and his family may have looked to public recreation, right? Places like pools and parks to have a bit of fun and to kind of let off some steam. In the summer of 1949, a family like Filberto's decided to travel to Waupun, which is in central Wisconsin, and try to enter the local pool to cool off and take the kids for a swim. But when a family like Filberto's traveled to a pond in the summer of 1949, this is what they found instead of an act of reception. They found this. The children were barred entry into the pool. The park custodian, Seymour Patrick, told the children that they could not enter because white parents didn't want their children to play with young Mexicans. They were afraid that Mexican children were carrying disease and were going to contaminate their children. Abject discrimination in the very places where people are working, right? We're not talking about Alabama. We're not talking about Mississippi. This is a form of segregation that's being practiced right here in the Midwest. So here's the question I have for you. What do you think happens to this custodian who bars these kids from entering the pool? And you can drop your guesses in the chat. What do you think happens to this custodian? His name was Seymour Patrick. What happens to him? Jameson says probably nothing. Mary says rewarded by white folks. That's an interesting one. Whenever I tell my students about this, one of the guesses is he was elected mayor the next year, which is kind of a dark guess, but I guess one that's colored by their by their perception of what might have happened in 1949. Well, here's a twist for y'all. Seymour Patrick, the custodian who barred these kids' entry, the very next day he is fired from his position. He loses his job. RJ is right, he should be fired, and that's actually what happens. He loses his job. Why does Seymour Patrick lose his job, right? Why does it kind of go against what our initial assumption might have been, that instead of being rewarded or applauded for this action, he actually is fired from his position? Well, you can see to the way in which Wisconsin and Midwestern institutions react to this type of discrimination. We can kind of get a clue on why he loses his job right away. The Milwaukee Sentinel, which was another paper published here in Wisconsin, publishes an editorial in November of 1952. And it's one that's arguing for Wisconsin residents to treat migrants better, to offer them a little bit more hospitality while they're here in the state. It's titled, Let's Give Migrants a Better Break. And I picked kind of one of the big reasons here that the Milwaukee Sentinel believes that Wisconsinites and Midwesternites should offer hospitality to these migrant farm workers. The Milwaukee Sentinel's editorial board says, migrant crews which swarm into Wisconsin by the thousands are an economic asset to the state and make the difference between success and failure in many of our harvesting operations. They give us valuable service and deserve decent treatment while they are giving it. I want us to kind of clue into that last sentence here. They give us valuable service and deserve decent treatment while they are giving it. The editorial board admirably is saying that Wisconsinites and Midwesterners should be more hospitable to these Texas Mexican migrants, that they should treat them with more respect. But why should they treat them better? Well, very specifically, because these migrant farm workers are performing a valuable service for the state and the region's agricultural industries. And I want you to kind of key in to the way in which they phrase this. They give us valuable service and deserve decent treatment while they're giving it. It is a form of hospitality. It is a form of welcoming that is contingent. It's contingent on the work that migrants can do. And you have to ask yourself the question, well, what happens when those migrants are no longer seen as economically useful? What happens when they are no longer seen as giving that valuable service? Will that outstretched hand of welcome still be there from Midwesterners? Well, we know that the way in which Midwesterners responded was a way of trying to save face, because agriculturalists across the Midwest knew that migrant farm workers had one very important power, right? They may not have been paid a lot of wages. They may have often lived in really rough situations, but they had the power of their feet. They had the power of migration. They could travel to whichever state they wanted to try to get the resources they needed, right? They could choose the farm that they're going to be employed at. And so rural communities across the Midwest began to kind of offer some incentives to try to show migrants that the Midwest was not just the actions of people like Seymour Patrick, that the Midwest could be welcoming. There were these migrant projects that popped up all across the region, often created by religious organizations, by Catholic and Protestant outreach groups, these organizations called migrant ministries. And they created these kind of these fiestas and these celebrations as kind of ways to invite migrants in. And for many Wisconsinites and many Midwesterners, they thought that this was it, that if they just kind of showed and put a nicer face on things, that they could solve the problem that had occurred in places like Waupun. You see here in August of 1950, the Milwaukee Journal says that Waupun had solved its race problem, which is kind of a stunning thing to think, right? That this newspaper believes that these Band-Aid solutions are the things that are going to fix the issues. And in fact, they didn't, right? Because the issue was not just that people were being mistreated when they went to the pool and that, you know, a little party was going to solve the issue. The problem was that migrant farm workers all across the Midwest faced some pretty destitute living and working conditions. This is what a housing may have looked like for one migrant family here in Wisconsin. And this is actually a decent living condition, which is hard to say, but that's because they had a roof and they had windows. This is what sugar beet workers and East Grand folks in Minnesota may have encountered, right? So, I mean, it's a really rough situation. And this is what migrants put up with in their best efforts to provide for themselves and their families. This is what a communal shower looked like in Wautoma, which is in central Wisconsin in 1969. This is 20 years after that incident in Waupun, right? This is the inside of that communal shower. You know, after this type of treatment, after being engaged in this type of work for decades, migrant farm workers, you can imagine, were pretty fed up with the conditions. And by the mid-1960s, migrant farm workers in the Midwest were very aware of what was happening all around the rest of the country. They were aware of the civil rights movement in the U.S. South that was slowly moving northward into urban spaces in places like Chicago, in Milwaukee and Detroit. They were also aware of migrant farm workers who were organized in places like California. They were aware of the work of Cesar Chavez and the Lourdes Huerta and Larry Itlong, who had created the United Farm Workers, a labor organization that organized and petitioned on behalf of migrant farm workers. And so all across the Midwest, including in places like Wisconsin, migrant farm workers began to put their feet down and to demand changes to these working conditions. This is Obreros Unidos, which was Wisconsin's first migrant farm worker union, founded in 1966. They organized a very dramatic march from the central fields of Madison, of Wisconsin to Madison, which is the state capital, demanding higher wages, demanding better living conditions, but more importantly, at the heart of their demands was the request, the demand for respect, right? To be treated as human beings, not just as potential workers. This sense of social activism that developed in rural parts of the Midwest eventually made their way into urban spaces as well. And they influenced the way in which many young Latinos, people of Mexican descent, of Puerto Rican descent, of Cuban descent, began to see themselves as both Latinos, but also as Americans. And so in urban spaces all across this region, we saw the development of movements for civil rights, for economic rights, movements against police brutality, movements for self-determination. Most dramatically in organizations like the Young Lords, which was a social movement organized by young Puerto Ricans in Chicago. It became a national movement that had an extension in New York as well. And in places like Milwaukee, you see here leaders of Milwaukee's Latino community that were organizing against police brutality and demanding better educational opportunities for the city's young Latino children. And the thing I want to point out here in this image is that many of these organizations and the social movements that developed were often interracial and were often interethnic. You see here an organization that's made up of young Mexican-American and Puerto Rican Milwaukeeans, and you see behind them kind of the pieces of their struggle, right? So you have an image of Emiliano Zapata, who is one of the fathers of the Mexican Revolution, and you have images from Puerto Rico demanding for Puerto Rican independence. I'm going to skip ahead here since I'm almost out of time, and I just want to really talk really quickly about the development of these communities in Midwestern spaces. And I'm going to come back to Wisconsin here. This is what Wisconsin's Latino population looked like in 1990. The majority of it was concentrated here in Southeast Wisconsin, which is the place where Latinos had been migrating to and settling to since really the early 20th century. This is in 1990. This is in 2014. I'm going to show you this change again very quickly. This is 1990. And this is 2014. The thing I want us to think about is the way in which Latino communities have grown all across the state. I showed you those census maps of the 2020 census for all those different states. This is what it looks like for Wisconsin, a 33% increase in our state's population within the last decade. And you see that it's happening in almost every single county except for one, right? 100% change in some of these places. And so we look at this type of a graph, and I want us to think about a few things. You know, it might just be a map with colors on it, but to me, I kind of see the way in which there are potential for growth, but also potential for tension, right? The way in which the arrival of people from Latin America and from different parts of the United States who call themselves Latinos, what that's going to do for some of these counties that have these darkly purple shaded regions, right? Where they have seen a 50% or a 100% increase in their Latino population. The arrival of new people to a region has always historically in the United States brought a series of questions, and they have not always been comfortable questions. And the reactions from native born Americans have not always been welcoming, whether that was in the early 20th century and the way in which they approach both European descent immigrants and Mexican immigrants or today. And beginning in the mid 2000s and into the 2010s, we began to see the way in which Midwesterners responded to the development of these growing Latino populations. And again, they were not always welcoming. For me, the example that I point to here in Wisconsin is the way in which in 2016, the Wisconsin legislature proposed a series of laws that would have further criminalized being undocumented in the United States. It would have empowered local law enforcement to basically function as the enforcement arm of ICE and the Department of Homeland Security. They would have allowed local sheriffs and local police officers to not only detain people that they suspected to be undocumented in the country, but actually hand them over to Immigration and Customs Enforcement to the Department of Homeland Security. These laws were proposed in Wisconsin. They were proposed in Iowa. They were proposed in other parts of the Midwest. But in Wisconsin, the response from Wisconsinites was actually pretty swift and it was pretty loud. In February of 2016, about 20,000 Wisconsinites went to the Capitol. And they said with one clear voice, this is not the type of law that we want to pass in Wisconsin. This is not who we want Wisconsin to be. And these laws never even made it out of the state house. They never even made it to the governor's desk. They never even made it out of the assembly. And so the laws never saw the light of day. They just were just proposals that were shot down. The romantic in us might say, wow, 20,000 people spoke with one clear voice and they said, this is not who Wisconsin is. This is not who we want the Midwest to be. But the reality is that those laws were not passed just because 20,000 people went to the Capitol and spoke with one clear voice. Those laws were not passed because dairy farmers across the state of Wisconsin picked up their phones and told their legislators that if these laws were passed, the dairy industry in Wisconsin would be decimated. Wisconsin, of course, has the number two dairy industry in the United States, and it is largely dependent on immigrant labor, and specifically, it is dependent on undocumented immigrant labor. Right? So those laws were defeated because it was economically incumbent upon the state to make sure that these people did not live in a consistent state of fear. And the questions of belonging and economic necessity are not just questions from 2016 and 2017. They are questions that we are still grappling with today in 2021, all across the Midwest. And specifically, Latino communities all across the Midwest are still grappling with this question. The language now here is about who is essential. Who is not only invited into the region, but who is necessary for the region's very, very economic future, for the very sustenance of the region's demographic growth. So we see these charts, we see these maps, and we think about the demographic growth of these regions, and we think about what it means to be essential in 2021, as the majority of these positions are filled by communities of color and often filled by Latinos and undocumented Latinos. I am drawn to, however, an alternative conception of belonging, and that's one that many young Latinos have been screaming from the top of their lungs for quite some time now, that their documentation status, their Latinidad does not define their sense of being a Midwesterner. It is the communities that they create. It is the relationships that they build. It is the sense of social belonging that they have facilitated in their time in this region. And so I am drawn to those dreamers, to those DACA recipients, to those undocumented children who say that they are the Midwest. They are Wisconsin just as much as anybody else. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sergio. If anyone has any questions, you could go ahead and type them into the chat or any comments. I don't see anything popping up right away. Well, nothing. I'm pretty thorough.
We'll give them a second, sure.
Let's see. Mary has a statement, just wondering about the dairy farmers.
Give me a little bit more, Mary. What do you mean? What do you wonder? I'm always wondering about dairy farming, maybe for different reasons.
I know many college and community colleges are offering degrees in dairy.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Well, you know, the dairy industry has been long in a state of crisis in Wisconsin. It's often, there's a few different reasons. One is because we have these like large corporations that are coming in and consolidating dairy farms. And so they're buying up what were once family farms. And so these were kind of lived within families for generations, and large corporations are coming in and buying them up and consolidating them. And so on one hand, there's crisis in that the dairy industry is no longer really a Wisconsin industry. It's kind of a, you know, a big corporation industry. But the other issue, of course, is that a lot of the reason that families are selling off their farms is that their kids are moving out of rural areas and into urban spaces. We see this out-migration, specifically white out-migration from rural spaces into either urban areas or kind of ex-urban areas. And so they have to sell off their farms because no one's going to work the farms. It's too expensive to actually man the farms. And where do they turn to? They turn specifically to Mexican descent labor and Central American descent labor, and specifically undocumented labor. And so many of those kind of those dairy degrees, which have really been at the heart of public institutions like the University of Wisconsin-Madison, which has had an extension school for dairy farmers since the turn of the century, they're not really cutting it. They're not the thing that are going to save these farms. Right now, it's undocumented labor, because that's the way that these farms can cut the corners that they need to, that they feel that they need to maintain their industry. And so one of the questions we have to ask ourselves, as we do about any industry that depends on a labor force that is kind of marginalized and is often taken advantage of, is, you know, what is the ethical responsibility we have as consumers as we partake in this economy, right? I mean, we are part of the ecosystem that allows for these things to continue.
A couple more questions. RJ asks, do you think the U.S. should be more welcoming in immigration?
The simple answer is yes, but I think that the United States need to, and Americans in general, need to have a very serious conversation about, you know, why they want immigrants to come to the United States. I think right now there are a lot of different discourses. One is often, you know, we should be more welcoming to immigrants because we have all of these positions that nobody can do, right? We need more workers. The Midwest has a declining population. We need more people to live in the Midwest. That to me just kind of follows the same patterns of the 20th century that really got us into trouble in the first place, right? That did not create the welcoming spaces for newly arriving immigrants. If our sense of welcome is, again, contingent on what we need from another group of people, the flip side of that question has to be, what happens when we don't need those things anymore? Does that mean that the country will no longer be welcoming to immigrants? And so I think we need to have a very serious conversation about what we believe is at the center of part of the American mythology, which is that, you know, this is a nation of immigrants. So it's always been kind of a nation of immigrants with an asterisk, right? There's always been kind of strings attached to that. And so I think if we're going to be more welcoming, which we should be, we should have a hard conversation about what being welcoming actually means. You're muted, Valerie, but I'm guessing you're reading Kat's question here. Were there other states faced with a decision about the laws regarding turning over undocumented immigrants to ICE? If so, what was the outcome? Yeah, I mean, what happened in Wisconsin in 2016 is actually a downward effect of what was happening in Arizona. So you may remember what happened in 2010. The Arizona legislature passed a series of laws, most famously SB 1070, State Bill 1070, which criminalized not just undocumented immigrants to the United States. Undocumented immigration, by the way, or illegal crossing into the United States is a misdemeanor in most cases. But state houses have the ability to kind of ramp up the penalties upon this. And state houses have the ability to basically empower local law enforcement to serve as the arm of immigration and customs enforcement. And so that's what happened in Arizona. And it led to a series of racial profilings that made their way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court struck down parts of those laws. But even after they struck down parts of those laws, we saw copycat laws in Alabama, in Georgia, and we saw them across the Midwest too. We saw them in Iowa, and we saw them pop up in Wisconsin. So where there were conservative state houses, we saw the laws pop up. They passed in Iowa, did not pass here in Wisconsin. They weren't even brought to the front in Illinois or Michigan or Minnesota. So you're muted, Valerie, so I can't hear you.
Sorry about that. Jameson, thank you for the interesting talk. I knew nothing about Latinx migration to the Midwest. Thank you, Jameson. RJ, if given a chance to become citizens, they can pay taxes and contribute, which would only help our country, I would think. Wow, do you think the trends will continue? Thank you.
Yeah, let me just address RJ's point. Yeah, I mean, the thing to, of course, note here is that immigrants pay taxes every single day that they go to the store. They pay taxes, they pay for the utilities, they pay for so many different pieces that are part of the American puzzle and part of the American economic puzzle. And so immigrants, regardless of their documentation status, are already deeply ingrained within our country's economic system and already paying into it. For those immigrants that have jobs that take out Social Security from their paychecks, if they're undocumented, they will never have access to those benefits, right? Undocumented immigrants don't have access to the Affordable Care Act. They don't have access to Social Security. They don't have access to welfare benefits, none of that, right? And so they're paying into a system that they themselves cannot benefit from. And so I think that's a really good point, RJ, that we have to have these conversations about kind of the economic implications. But in many ways, the economic implications are already playing out. Mary's question, do I think the trends will continue? Yes, but they're going to be different from how we've understood them. Since the 2008 recession, the number of people entering in the United States has actually been in steep decline, right? So one of the big reasons people come to the country, that there are jobs here, has dried up after 2008. So there's no really big reason to come here. Also, the United States has begun to solidify its border, right, to actually harden its border. So it's harder for people to go back and forth and across. And so many people are staying permanently in the United States. So some of the largest growths that we're seeing specifically in the Midwest are not from immigrant populations, they're from the children of immigrants. So we're not talking about Latino immigrants, we're talking about Latino Americans, right? Mm-hmm. These are our children who are American citizens. And so the conversations are gonna look very different, I think, over the next 20 or 30 years as those populations continue to grow.
I think that's it as far as, RJ, very true. What do you think the children who are separated, what do you think of the children who are separated from their parents?
Well, yeah, I think you're referring to under the previous administration, the children, specifically those arriving from Central American nations who were separated at the U.S.-Mexico border and then were kind of sent off into different holding facilities into foster care across the United States, often done so without any sort of documentation or very loose documentation to kind of make sure that those children could be reunited with their families at some point. It's an atrocity. It's unfortunately, I think, as historians have noted, not the first time that this has happened in the United States. And it follows within a long pattern that is not just a history of Mexican or of Central American descent people. This is the history, of course, of indigenous populations and boarding schools in the United States and specifically in the Midwest, right? This is a history that's part of our region very much so, the way in which the U.S. government took U.S. children from indigenous families and sent them off to Americanization schools in an effort to try to Americanize Indian communities. And so I hope that these children will one day be reunited. But my fear, of course, is that Americans are very myopic in their historical thinking. And so the fear, of course, that this will happen again sometime when we forget that this happened already once in our nation's history.
I don't see any other questions in the chat or the Q&A. A travesty, thank you for your informative presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, RJ.
Well, thank you, Sergio. It was a pleasure listening to you, and I learned quite a bit, as I'm sure our audience did as well. Some thank yous coming in. So thank you all for joining us tonight, and have a great evening. And if we will put the recording of our program up on our YouTube channel. Is it okay if we leave it up there for a couple of weeks? Okay.
Sounds good.
So if you want to share this with friends or replay the lecture, it'll be on our YouTube channel tomorrow. I'll get it up there in the afternoon. Thank you, Sergio. Have a good night.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.